meteorology. Its primary astronomical interests are in deep sky observing, telescope building, CCD imaging, supernova searching, astro computing, and the related gadgetry. David also upholds the distinction, along with Paul Grady and Beverly Wurstia, I hope I pronounced that correctly, of being the first Canadians to discover a supernova from within Canada, this occurring in February of this year, of course. It is noteworthy that Earth-centered universe was controlling the telescope used to discover the supernova, and those notes on the day were taken away from the Earth-centered universe manual. I'm sure that they would like to see many people more familiar with that. Without further ado, I'll ask Dave and Paul to come forward to give their talk now.
Sent his office one day and I said, how hard would it be for CCD camera observatory, maybe it would be for real supernova search instead. However, the only thing was is the observatory would be a medium upgrades. It really wasn't upgraded since the time it was built in 1972 when first opened, and it was not up to the task. It was looked at that. Dave basically told me, you go about looking for the information of what do we have to do to look, where do we look, and what do we want to look at, how do we go about doing a search, and you'll basically tackle the task of how can I get the telescope to do a search. Pretty well where it was left off at that time. Now that Dave will.
Okay, next slide, turn on. Yes, on. Just briefly, just tell you a little bit about the observatory first before we start. That's St. Mary's University, which is in downtown Halifax, south end of the city. And the observatory sits on top of the 24th floor of residence building. Not exactly the most ideal place to put an observatory, but it is very convenient. It's close to, it's close to my office, for one. Well, actually, it's not. It's 22 floors away. It's a pain, but it's close to population, human population, and that's the reason it's put there, is because, A, someone was nice enough to donate money and said it had to be there, so obviously, that's where we would put it. And the second reason is it's easily accessible to students and to the public at large because it is primarily a teaching observatory. Up until the work that's been done recently, it really hasn't been done much research of any kind. There's some small projects over the years, but nothing particularly significant, other than the work that was done by Meredith Whitehorn, who obtained her Chang Medal last year. 93, as a result of using telescopes and spectroscopy. This is a picture of the dome, 16-foot dome, sitting on the roof. It is the weirdest mechanical design I've ever seen. The dome sits essentially freestanding, no structure underneath it except these two piers and that's the building. But surprisingly, it doesn't seem to shake in the wind or anything. There's no evidence that the design was wrong. The telescope is a 16-inch, for those in metric, I guess I should be metric, but it's a 40.7 centimeter reflecting telescope. It's a Cassegrain. Lots of Cassegrains. It's the primary back here, secondary, and the primary focus is the Cassegrain focus, or the only focus, I should say, is Cassegrain focus, the back of the telescope. It also has a couple of auxiliary telescopes, small 3-inch refractors, which are used for guiding and for using the finder scope. The mount is just a fairly heavy, 1,500-pound, up-pound German observatory. The first thing that really had to be done to bring it up to be able to do the project we wanted to do was to get the motors working. It really had a lot of problems before I arrived. It's not reliable. So the first thing I did is simply gutted the electronics and replaced it all with modern microprocessor controls. And I allowed the option for a computer to actually move the telescope around. And that's what really allowed the automation to proceed. And but the first project really was to, after the motors were fixed, we put sensors on the axes to measure the position of the telescope. So basically what I did, instead of spending several $1,000s to have an engineering company come in and add encoders, I did what amateurs do. I bought a $40 encoder in the same place that sells encoders to amateurs. And overall, we're able to obtain about, I guess it's roughly half arc minute resolution. So really fairly high resolution compared to the size of our CCD frame. So that was number one, is to get position sensors on both axes. So the telescope position could be transferred to the computer. Now, the warmer, this is the adjacent room, looking through the double doors in the observatory. I guess the windows are looking to the west. There's two computers. One controls the telescope and
out back of the warm room, or the cold room, I should say, the observatory, there's a duplicate display keyboard. So that although we don't use this primarily for running a telescope and supernova search, we do use it for public tours and for initially aligning the telescope. Basically, all it is a duplicate display of the telescope control computer. It makes it so you don't have to be running back and forth between the doors. That piece there is actually the most expensive part of the whole upgrade. Cost about half the upgrade cost, which is having a duplicate display. To be able to make this thing, keep this thing nice and warm so it'll run in the winter time, that's the main, and waterproof, that's the main there. Just a quick look at the computer screen before we'll get back to this a little later on. We'll talk about how we actually do the search. But basically what happens is the crosshair gets positioned on the screen where the telescope is pointed. It's real time, so the telescope moves and follows it. And we get the telescope position real time. And we get buttons to be able to manually move the telescope around and focus it. Zoom in, we see an actual rectangle which represents the actual CCD chip, a piece of the sky that it sees, and the other circle is the field of view of the eyepiece, the field lens, which we use to align center objects and so on. To find something, see, this is matters just as simple as looking on an object, pressing the center scope button, and the telescope rushes there 30 times the Earth's rotation rate. It's not that fast, but it's fast enough for what we're doing, and it's sort of the limitation of the motor, which are currently in the telescope. They don't have any power to move faster than that. Sometimes I think we've gone too far, and our operators are falling asleep on the job. Actually, this is a 5-second exposure or something. Another thing we do, just for effect, is we have a nice red light bulb that shines in the ceiling and gives us that sort of red tint that we're all used to as deep sky observers. And we usually run under the red light, not because we need to really protect the night vision, but because we feel guilty. Sitting in our corners, using a telescope. We often joke that while we're doing this, especially in the wintertime, like Beetlejuice would probably go supernova, and the outside, you can't see the sky. We'll miss it.
The other thing is curtains are normally closed as well. So normally we're sitting there, we don't even see a star at night. We can go in, start up, go home, get up to the building afterwards, we look up, the skies are like. And sometimes we leave and it's hazy, the moon's hazed over, we're still doing imaging.
I just want to show a slide of the CCD camera. We made it a little bit easier to use than a typical amateur setup, mainly because it has to be graduate student proof. not always easy. Maybe I'll be even crueler and say it has to be faculty proof. Except for a couple who don't use the telescope very often, so it has to be fairly easy for them to set up the telescope and attach the camera and so on. So what we've done is essentially take the electronics and mount it in permanently in this watertight box. And to set up, all they have to do is take the camera out of its carrying case, plug it in the back of the telescope, and with this huge electrical connector, just connect it up so that it's nice and clean. There's no wires anywhere that it could be ripped off by screening 10-year-old, 5-year-old, 7-year-old cubs that are in there every Monday night. It's an important aspect of the clock. And this is a lousy picture of just the down the throat, I guess, of the camera, just to give you an idea of the size of the chip. So it's a small rectangle, it must be about 12 millimeters or so by 10, something like that. The end result, given the focal length of the telescope, gives us a very small field of view, and that'll come up a little later on. It's about 4x6 arc minutes, so it's a very small piece of sky, and that's why we get a very accurate pointing system to be able to point this telescope at things you can't see. Because the light pollution where this is located is bad, real bad. The skylight is typically about limiting visual magnitude somewhere around 4, maybe a little more, maybe 4.5 on a good night. And we're about 1 kilometer from 500,000 watts of the container here. And our worst enemy is our own football stadium, which when they turn the lights on, you can read a newspaper inside the dome and turn these. So that's the problem. But fortunately, sports, particularly football, is a very high priority at St. Mary's. So we're working at changing that, because I think during the supernova search, we've got more publicity for the university than they had not lost the conflict we've ever been here. Anyway, the quarter's not here, so. Okay, I'll stop there and let Paul continue on.
So, after all the upgrades were in place, actually last spring 1994, we went in and we actually took the CCD camera, attached it to the 80-millimeter finder scope on the big telescope, and said, well, let's see what we can do with this thing. And lo and behold, we reached 15th magnitude galaxies in that map, finder scope. So, we kind of realized that, okay, we do have the capability of doing this. The last thing that had to be done was every other year, up in Ontario to get recoded. And last time I saw the Dave Lane come up to go to Starfest, so we did the crate and brought it with this rocket up at the Dave Lane Observatory. Went to Starfest and on the way home, stopped at the observatory, picked up the mirror, got a tour of the observatory, and brushed shoulders with each other. Then went home and a week later, so on August 16th, started the supernova search. And the night of August 16th was our first night in. We did 17 galaxies in about 2 hours of work. Well, again, just the system and knowing how to run things and just get our team on going. But that was the official start almost 2 years after the idea was first brought up. So that's when it all started. Now, I'm going to let Dave go into the next part of the lecture.
Still thought he was crazy at that time.
He still didn't think it could be done.
Well, before we get into how we did it, let's say, well, why? Why do this? Why? Before we say why, what is a supernova? And I'll just give a very brief boil down what is a supernova. And, well, supernova marks the end of the life of a star in a very wild way, to say the least. I was surprised when I started doing a little bit of research into supernovas that I didn't realize it was like 10 billion times the brightness of our sun. I mean, wow, that's really a, I see why they say it's the most violent explosion or event in the universe. It's incredible. It's like a big bang. Just to go back and see what the super comes from. Nova is just an ordinary star, not an ordinary star, but I guess an ordinary star that has a companion material on them, eventually it just flares up for a while and fades back. But they're not nearly as energetic as a supernova. A supernova is obviously much brighter, and the explosion of the light, so the light coming from it is a completely different process. Not all supernovae are alike. They come from several different types. There's a lot of controversy as to why, what these things actually are. There are two primary types, type 1 and type 2, and the difference is determined by their spectrum classification. They take a spectra and compare the absorption and emission lines, and they fall into roughly two categories, type 1 and type 2, and their subtypes. So, why search for supernovas again? Well, it doesn't seem to be very much known about them. That's the main reason, and the more these things can be discovered and studied, the more hopefully we'll be able to learn more about them. We won't be learning, we will be just finding, and hopefully the professionals will follow up on the brighter ones. The other thing is, it's an area of research where amateurs can actually do something useful. Large telescopes, or professional telescopes in particular, are high demand. You can't spend hundreds of hours looking for something you may never find. And also, if amateurs are not paid, if you probably figure how much it would cost to find a supernova, I don't think we'd want to know if we actually paid ourselves a salary, other than the fact that they paid me up here to tell us. So I guess that was going to happen anyway. But it is something that we as amateurs can do, and it's useful. All Type 1As are believed to be standard candles. They're believed to all have the same intrinsic brightness. I guess there's some controversy in that, but we won't eliminate that controversy without finding more of them. And we can find more of them and correlate somehow through other means, find out how far away the galaxies are, we can solve that problem. And the idea is that if they all are the same brightness, they can be used to help nail down the Hubble constant, which seems to be, I call it Hubble variable, it seems to be. But they're believed to produce us. We come from supernovas. They're the place where many elements are manufactured, so that's kind of neat, especially when you tell kids that they come from exploding stars. And last but not least, it's lots of fun. We wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't fun, after all, right? We need to do this. Paul's going to tell us now what methodology we use to search for these things.
All right, this is probably my part of the talk, the very start. About how we're going to do this, like, are we going to look, what are we going to look at, and so on. And one of the common things that I recall from the PBS show way back when I first got interested in astronomy was hearing somewhere after being shown this discovery that supernovas are more common than spiral galaxies. So automatically, there you go. Spiral galaxies is a place to start, I guess. And actually, I came across a paper that was written on rates of supernova and the idea of doing searches in certain parts of the sky. One just happens to about searching the northern part of the sky, which I'll get into in a minute. And we actually got a hold of that after we started our project. But, the original idea was stick to spiral galaxies, maybe a few irregulars, but otherwise stay away from the electric poles in the areas that aren't really common for supernovas. So I basically went up to the library, sat down in the Sky Catalog 2000, and started going through that thing for galaxies that would meet my criteria, not just spiral galaxies. But we also had the problem of knowing that when we take a picture of a galaxy with a camera, that is going to be there. We've got to be able to see it. I mean, you can't take a picture of a field that have a few stars on it, not people recognize it. You never know if you're on the galaxy. You might wait to be searching for some part of our own galaxy out in the nowhere, and your chances will be diminished. So we said, okay, if we can image a 14-magnitude galaxy, we will at least see the core of the galaxy on the image. So we said, take spiral galaxies that are 14 right, limits it down a little, we can get a half decent number of that. The other idea that they mentioned earlier was the size of our chip. It's only, the part of the sky that we image is only about 4 minutes by 6 minutes in size. So if you're imaging a galaxy that's twice the size of that, you're only missing part of the galaxy you're looking at, which will then again decrease your odds of finding a supernova in the galaxy. You could be looking at one corner, and the other side of the galaxy, and the other arm somewhere. So we had to make sure that every galaxy we would image would be small enough that we could actually see it all at the step that we were lined up on the problem. So that gave us three criteria. The other idea is where exactly in the sky to look. And this idea came up right from the start. This is probably one of the things that I convinced Dave here to think, hey, this could be possible. And that was, let's look where nobody else is, or let's look where most people aren't. That is in the northern sky, either right around the North Pole or just below the North Pole. On the horizon. The idea was that automated telescopes, what we see as a competition, and I think any amateur astronomer searching for supernova would see as a competition, are all located further south. Just as a give you an idea, this is our ECU plug in here, but this is our sky looking north of Halifax at our latitude. And the idea is to search. Originally, was the search that in this area of tropics, our scope would be, we'd have about a limit of 15 degrees above the horizon. But if you were to go down to where automated searches are, maybe down to New Mexico, maybe Arizona, places like that, that part of the sky would be too low. As we all know, I don't know, really like looking low to the horizon because there's too much atmosphere to look through, maybe smoke, fog, whatever it may be. So everybody looks looking high. And most of the automated searches do that. They like to stay up high and keep going back and forth across the sky, high in the sky. So as far as we believe, there's probably no real automated searches checking in this area of the sky, around here, and so on. So that was the main idea. Let's look north, hopefully nobody else is. We know there's amateurs visually looking north photographically, but with CCD cameras, we haven't really heard of anybody doing it. So that was our really key success. A couple members in Halifax came up and called us sleazy, and saying that it had to work eventually because of the way we came up with the idea for that.
Sleazy
Nova Scotia, yes. But if it works, they'll knock, right? The next idea, of course, is doing it in a way that it's going to be efficient. Go up into the galaxy, one part of the sky, and then reload the galaxy in another part of the sky. It's going to take time. And that's really where your Center Universe program came in, is having the program modified a little and kind of oriented towards the observatory to do work with this telescope, to point the telescope for us accurately, and as they eventually get close to a half hour resolution. Encoders. So what we can pretty well do now is we picked a small part of the sky, took our galaxies that were 14th magnitude or brighter and spiral, barely clustered together, maybe a degree apart at most. The slewing time between one galaxy and the next would not be that great. And as it worked out, most of the groups here have got a, this is just an example of the bowl of first major, where we actually have a group of, I think it's 25 or 30 galaxies. And we can start over here at Merak. We kept a list of the computer, actually, it's David, which is not out there. And we just kind of follow the lines here, connect the dots, and scope the sleep one to the next. And we just pick the fastest pattern, the shortest distances between all those galaxies. And what it actually works out to, in the end, is the time it takes for the scope to sleep one galaxy to the next. Normally, on average, is about the amount of time it takes to download the image of the last galaxy, compare it to our golden image, and save it. So by the time we're done checking one, the scope's finally stopped, so we can take a picture of the next one. So it worked out pretty good. And we would break all the galaxies up. We have about 250 on the list of galaxies. We would break them up in groups like this. We have seven or eight groups around different parts of the northern sky that we watch during different seasons. It's really the way that we went about it. And they would come on now.
Well, now we have a methodology which we need volunteers. We have lots of volunteers, but to plot the effort per volunteer probably be an exponential function. With Paul and I on the left side of the graph and the scattering of probably about seven or eight people with lesser and lesser amounts of involvement. Most of the active members of the group were members of the Halifax Center. Should mention a few names just so to get them on the record. Sean Mitchell is one. He's our librarian. He's there almost every third night. You almost can't convince him to go real observing now because it's so convenient and warm. Then you have to try to change that around, force him to try in the mirror. So. Who else? Go ahead.
Off the top of my head, members, Dave Lane, myself, and the original members, Sean Mitchell is the next really active member of the club. Tom Harp.
Of course, I am.
Tom Harp, graduate students were Bradley Wurstiak, Stephanie Lipp, Gary Gibney. Mel Blake was a student who really got active in the later part of it and helped us out a lot with making adjustments. Calculating the magnitude of the supernova once it's found, and get a lot of imaging of it afterwards to get magnitudes for later Earth. Another member that was active, wasn't really a member of the Halifax Center, was a member of the Nova Central Astronomy Club located in Sherwood, North Scotia, and that was Darren Tubb. He was up a number of occasions with us as well. well, probably more often than many of the graduate students. That's a fair distance away.
He was a past member of the Toronto Center and the NYAA as well.
Okay, well, as I say, anytime we have a clear night and some volunteer slave labor available, we select a group of galaxies that's positioned properly. We usually try to pick something, again, this is the sleeves factor, something that's setting in the west, sort of in the north, so that we get it before it's risen by people out west and down south. If we observe something on the east side, it'll eventually swing all the way back up over. So it's probably not a good one, a good group to use. But unfortunately, conditions vary from night to night. Sometimes the haze is just so bad, you have to shoot overhead. Also, you have to remember that the city is actually north of the, most of the city is north of the Earth, so you're looking over most of the actual pollution. North is going to be the worst light pollution. South is not actually that bad. But if we can just put on the slides, I guess, it's probably on. We usually have groups of 2 to 3. People who were there that night is myself, taking a picture of Paul and Beverly Wurstiuk, who's graduated from Carleton. She's now a graduate student at St. Mary's, and Darren Talbot. Basically, we sit there and stay under the red lights in the field building. And we image galaxies. We find galaxies using the Earth's Sun universe. We have them all programmed into a list of objects. They're all pre-typed in. And we just select the next one, those key sequences, so you don't have to use the mouse if you want to. And then we tell it to move the telescope there. And with any luck, it's there. We take an image of it on the other computer. While we're doing that, we bring up the reference image. This is a typical image of a galaxy that we get. They are lousy images, but you don't need good quality images of nebulosity. All you need to be able to do is see some sort of hazy bit which identifies if you're on the galaxy. In this case, you can see sort of a hindrance of where it's spiral. And you need to be able to see faint stars. Typical magnitude limit is about 17, maybe a little fainter on the worst nights. We take 45-second exposures using the standard software that comes with the ST6 camera, and about a minute and a half later, the image comes up, and it's quite a scientific technique we use to check the supernova. It's basically the look left and right about 10 times. I'm convinced that that's probably faster than a computer would probably as good a job as a computer could do. Because the nights vary so much, and the camera gets put on a different orientation and so on, it'd be very difficult to come up with some sort of a subtraction and be able to subtract the images correctly to see a supernova. There wasn't one in this galaxy. We also see, a lot of times we see things like noise spikes and cosmic rays and things that cause us to have to redo an image or retake the galaxy just to make sure. We always have suspects. And I think the next slide will show that. And we usually have to go to other reference sources. If our reference galaxy image, which we've taken at some previous date, is not as good as, say, the one we took on a given night, then we have to go to other reference sources. And we're lucky enough to have access to the digitized Palomar Sky Survey, which is 101 CD-ROMs, which essentially is the entire sky digitized to 2 arcsecond resolution from the original Palomar glass plates. So they go down to about 21.5 magnitude. So much fainter than ours. Maybe looking for how this correlates. Well, it does, but this is flipped upside down. So that star is this star. I think the suspect in this case was, I think it was that something like that star there. So we would check and, well, there it is. It's this star. Yeah, probably that one. Anyway, so we have, oftentimes the next day, I'm the one who gets saddled to have to go check these things, because if you don't check them, law will say that it will be a supernova that will be announced 1 week from when you get the check. Anyway, that happens. We'll find it later on. You want to put the overhead up, Paul. One thing we found was accurate records are very important. Any sign scientific endeavor. If you don't record what you do, you cannot remember, especially at 2 o'clock in the morning. And we always record, obviously, what the images that we take, the exposure, the time, the filter we use, if any. Usually we shoot wide open, no filters. This particular night we shot through a red filter because we forgot to take it out. But it didn't seem to make much difference. In fact, this was the day that we decided to change to 45 seconds because it didn't seem to be as good. So anyway, we used to shoot 30 seconds prior to this. Anyway, we go down to the list and we just put okay because there's no supernova. But if there's a better image, we want to update our database, we just mark down better image so that later on we can go update our reference image. And sometimes we get problems. You can see here comments, sucks, trail stars, and maybe rebalance also. Again, it's important to have proper adjectives. And sometimes we have stars that we have to check because they're suspects and we have better images like to talk about. Sometimes we find errors in the databases. When you start having a camera that's only 4 by 6 minutes apart, and you go point at a galaxy and the galaxy's not there, you wonder there might be something wrong. We have found several errors in the NGC catalog. Positional errors, I should say. So we're going to hopefully get those errors corrected in the database and sent on to the source if they get corrected. Usually about 40 to 60 galaxies in a given night. We get about 15 to 30 an hour, 15 to 25 an hour, so depending on how efficient we are, how practiced we are. I guess that's it for that. And I think we're back to Paul, who's going to tell us how we actually, the sequence of events that have led to the discovery of the supernova.
This is probably the story everybody wanted to hear. This is what actually happened from the day we went in and found something to the day that we found out we actually got something. That time period was about 2.5 weeks. And, it all started on February 10th of this past year. Actually, I should say, for the month of December, of course, was good, but about a dozen nights. And the month of January started off with 2 nights clear, and January 15th, cloudy over on as well. Next clear night was February 10th, November 1st, clear night. And this particular night, we were back in the observatory, and for the first time, we decided, let's do this year, new group, fairly new group, the seasons are changing. And I did attempt to start this group at one time in January, and we got about 15 galaxies into it, and cloud over on normal. So this particular night, February 10th, there was a group of us in there, and we managed to accomplish take pictures of this entire group. Now, except for the first 15 galaxies that I looked at on the previous night, the rest of the galaxies in this search group were all new. We never looked at them before. We had no references, images, nothing. And it was on this particular night of February 10th, 10:03, we took an image of the GC2726. This is what we saw. And the nice photographs are right here, the nice smudge of the galaxy, and the other. I sat there and looked at it, remember the first day except there, kind of looked at me, I looked at the day, so we don't have a reference image. Can't do that. Oh, my folks. You gotta check it. It's like, well, save it anyway, I'll check it tomorrow. But by this time, he's already had four more than he had to check the next day. As he said, he's got to do this while he's at work, so. We debated for a few minutes, we saved it, we said, I'll check it anyway, and this was a Friday night, though. So they were like, well, I'll check it Monday. It. We left it at that. So that particular night, there was, like I said, Dave Lane, myself, Bradley Bursley were present. There was Stephen Doyle, Mike Casey, and Wayne Barker, two graduate students were observers. However, they left about 9:30 according to the log, so they missed that. It's too bad. So Monday came along, and Dave, of course, went to work, and he's going to check that image. And, he checked it on the Palmer Sky Survey plates that they have at the university. And sure enough, the survey of this galaxy was overexposed, being a fairly bright galaxy from the core. And this here star is about 2 to 3 arc seconds from the core of the galaxy, so it was lost in the glow of the galaxy. could have been on the plates, might not have been on the plates, we couldn't really say for sure. But luckily enough, what arrived in the mail that day? Digitized polymer sky survey on CD-ROM. So they like break down in the office with the CDs and box them in front of one, hold it up, and there's an image. Also, as you can see, quite overexposed. There's a foreground star there, but one of the galaxies would probably be right there. So what can we do? Got nothing to do. Monday night was clear again. This is 3 days later. We're back in the observatory, another clear night. We had a third school hour, so we had Monday nights, Wednesday nights. Friday night I wasn't working because I was part time, of course, being a student myself. Saturdays and Sundays, and there's no course and so on, being in there. Some Monday nights also, there was a public horoscopes and so on, so we'd actually go in and wait until they're done. And then we'd start researching on some Tuesdays and Thursdays were dire straits of needing a real night, because it's been a while since we had a real night. We'd go in, and graduate students would be finishing their work at 10 o'clock, and then we'd start ours. So on. So, the night of the 13th, Monday, February 13th, we went back in, and they showed us the images and all. And myself and Jody Clark said, well, let's go down to the graduate lab downstairs and go through all the labels, shape this catalog and so on, galaxies, and a whole catalog of galaxies, and look for it, see if we can find an image somewhere of this galaxy of such lot. So that particular night, we took another image of our own galaxy, and sure enough, the star was still up off its corals. Then blue was still the same brightness. Okay, that's good. And we decided we'll take a couple pictures, we'll go on. We started looking at another galaxy. And we went on and looked at another group, which we call DMA1 group, or as a beta group, it's a group of death. It's a group of galaxies of about 56 or 60 galaxies in the group. It takes a good 4 hours of work to get through it all. Sometimes, more often than not, we don't finish it. So it's going to be cut down some days to get chopped. We went through that group, not this particular name, the image of galaxy, the GC2441. There's your image. Not too great. A bit of spiral structure, some nice couple of foreground stars. Fine. Dandy. So this was Monday, the 13th of February. We'll just keep that in mind now. I'll come back to that in a minute. Present that night were David Lane, myself, Gary Kidney, Asco, Jordan Clark, and Noah Lake, which you mentioned earlier as well. So that night ended up with no real progress on this possible suspect, no real new suspects in the galaxies. Tuesday, February 14th, Valentine's Day, the university loved that. They thought that they were due. They almost made up the discovery date, the press release, but they thought it just sounded nice, right? I don't know. The 14th, anyway, came along. Us at school, and our SMGs, we got to do something here. We really got to get help somewhere. So that afternoon, I told the crisis, we'll tell the problem here this afternoon. I took off to the day's office. While I got there, we argued about what we decided that we send out an email on the internet to a group of Novus researchers asking for help. And in actual fact, this is going to go public. This is saying we have some people. Does anybody have an image of this galaxy in a picture? Somebody help us. And we waited. And we answered that what happened. Thursday we got a letter back. And it came from Harvard, Peter Garnovich at Harvard. And he came back and this is what he sent us. It was a pulled the image over, compared it to the plates. First of all, we got a message from saying that they would check the plates and asking us to send in their image to the FTP. So we put the FTP at the end of their site, printed it out, compared it to the Harvard plate collection. And in fact, saying this on February 16th, saying, good news, I pulled your image and compared it to the plates. We don't see a bright star in the galaxy, probably not a supernova. So we're like, this is it. But then we kind of got stumped. This idea of what then guys was your image. Third plates were blue sensitive, CCDs are red sensitive. If it was a very red star, we would have detected it, and their images might not have. So it could still have been a foreground star if it was very red. However, he went on to say that we should report it, and mention our days, and so on, said that prayer gives a little bit of credibility, I guess. So that was February the 16th, and it was then the day called me and said, put it all in the office, get everything together, send it off. So that night they went in and sent all the information off, and the real waiting began. So we reported it, reported it. We waited, and we got this guy saying it'll probably be night of the 23rd before they get a telescope or a spectrogram on and do a check. So we're thinking this is the 16th, we've seen it on the 10th, we're going to wait for the 23rd. It's going to be 2 weeks after we first seen it that they're going to look at it and actually find out if it's really a supernova. So much for the quick release of getting it out there, getting it reported, getting it checked. I kind of went down tuned on this one. However, then we did tell us that if we ever do get a suspect again, don't bother going anywhere else, go straight to him. And he has the connections to get it checked out. So, all this stuff about making sure you get questions confirmed before you report it kind of went out the window for us as well. On Monday night, I was talking to Dave Lane, and he mentioned that some group of Italian observers might have discovered a supernova. And I was like, yeah, we're at it. It's in some galaxy up in the north. Didn't really know what's going on. And then he came back next to me and said, well, I think it's one of our galaxies, actually, right? I'm like, which one? And he said, 2441. I'm like, no. He says, well, maybe they're just seeing some extra details. He got up by where the position was, and where the position was where we see some nice detail in the galaxy. So we're seeing something, right? The night of the 22nd, we're back in our observatory. It was supposed to clear up. And while we're there playing around with the auto-guider and stuff, it was actually the project for the next to try out the auto-guider project. And I decided to check my email. And sure enough, there's an IA circular announcing the discovery of supernova 1995E in the GC2441. It was discovered on Monday, the 20th. And sure enough, we went up and took a later picture of it. Here's the supernova in the circuit picture, which is the galaxy that we see. If you look back at our picture that we took on 7 days earlier, the 13th, you see it right now. This was actually noticed by the people in the observatory the night that we took that picture. We argued about it, we said it was detail, saved it, went on. We dismissed it as nothing. We did, however, get a rediscovery for this image. We recorded it immediately after hearing about it, of course. We got up, kicked a few chairs, said a few things. Knowing that we actually had an image of a supernova 7 days before anybody else missed it, and not knowing whether our reported possible supernova is one or not, still may not be. It's kind of frustrating at the time. It's like we could be chasing a wild goose chasing. However, we did get our first publication in the circular. That was nice. We were all happy about that. That's all exciting. But we still had to wait because it was the next night that we were finally going to go check for us.
Well, we waited and we waited and we waited. And finally, it's Friday, the 24th. I took that day off from work because I was late getting Novanote's newsletter to the Tech Center out, so I took that day off to get some things done before I left to go to Winter Star Party a few days later. And one of the things I was working on was Novanote's. And of course, what we have on our front cover, astro photo of the month. It's highly biased. It has a lot of power users in it because no one else seems to be submitting anything. But anyway, I thought I'd put the suspect image on. I was just typing the caption of suspected supernova. So I said, I'll check my email. And I log on to St. Mary's mainframe and check my email. And lo and behold, the official announcement from the astronomer who actually took the spectra at the observatory. His name is Alex Golpenko. He sent us a copy of what he said to Dan Green, essentially saying, you have a live one. Here's the discovery. And then within an hour, the circular came by email. And things changed at that point. Couldn't reach Paul. He was at school. So it took a while before he found it, but I told Mary the white one.
Word sure spread fast.
Before long, Harry Dickinson knew, I think he was the third, Roy Bishop knew, and it seemed like everyone in North America knew. Anyway, that's sort of where my participation ended, because I hopped on the plane and before. And that's where we went from there. But there's sort of a significance on this circular. It's got a lot of Canadian connections. Robert Evans discovered supernova. Why doesn't this work? Very famous, just like ours. Robert Evans discovered a supernova visually using a 1 meter telescope. Holy smokes. And he's an honorary member of the RASC. David Balaam reported a precise position. Of course, he's an RASC member and for the University of Victoria. And last but not least, I understand Alex Philip Anker has some, or Barker, this has some Canadian connection, but I'm not sure what it is. And, but just to give you an idea of what we know about supernova 1995F, well, not a whole lot. It's a fairly faint supernova in a basically obscure galaxy, and there hadn't really been too much studies of this galaxy before. There's basically nothing in the literature. Supernova started out of discovery around 15th magnitude. Unfortunately, the night of discovery, we did another FUPA. We saved the image as a TIFF file, not as a scientifically valid file, so we have no way of knowing what the actual brightness was during the night of discovery. But on the 14th, it was about 14.7 magnitude. And over the next month, we were a little bit concerned because we were following it, and we're thinking in our mind, red star. And it wasn't really coming that fast, as fast as expected. And by March 20th, it dropped to 15.2, so in over a month, it really only dropped about half a magnitude, which I kind of expected to drop quicker. A little later on, late February, early March, turned out that another group had imaged the galaxy pre-discovered to us. So they came up with a magnitude of 14.3, and that's probably fairly close to the maximum. That was on the 7th. So that's sort of the brightness. As far as the type is concerned, it's type 1C, which is a relatively strange type. It's not the type at all associated with type 1A, which are the ones which thought to be all the same brightness. It's thought to result from, and this is a direct quote of someone who said, this is what they think they might be, to result from core collapse of massive stars that have previously lost their outer layer of hydrogen, that's a 1B, or helium, a 1C. Ours is perhaps a 1C, they do not for sure. These supernovas are about four times less luminous than the type 1A, so they're not quite so bright. And they only occur in spirals and irregular galaxies. The galaxy itself is NEC 276. I observed it visually, it can be seen in probably 8 or 10 telescope. The supernova was not visible in anything, at least up to 17.5. Roy Bishop tried to find it in his fairly soon after discovery and could not see it. Perhaps the fact that it's sitting so close to the core made it difficult to distinguish. The galaxy is an SA, it's almost completely devoid of any detail. It's on the Balmer survey, it basically looks like almost like an elliptical, but apparently is an SA, about 12.5 magnitudes. So it's traveling away from us at about 1,500 kilometers per second, which, depending on who you ask, means it's about 56 million to 100 million light years away. So it's fairly far out. Roughly, I guess, around the distance of the Virgo crossing. And that's basically what we know about the supernova. And Paul's just going to conclude. I think we're doing okay for time. Just conclude where we're going to go from here.
Before I mention that, I mentioned earlier at the start of the entire program, we came back and started to stop at the observatory in Richmond Hill and our shoulders at Dean Shelton. Our announcement came out on February 24th, which is 8 years of the day of Dean Shelton's discovery in 1978. Just a tidbit. Too coincidental. Anyway, where do we go now? Well, the original ideas continued the search. We did go in a number of nights after the discovery and did magnitude estimates and continued searching. However, springtime in our town is quite horrible for weather and observing. It's pretty bad by the time it gets good at summertime. And as you know, me and David are both deep sky observers. We like to take our 13-inch light bucket to the dark sky, and the warm weather comes and the moon's out of the sky. The observatory is nice, but we want to get it to the dark side, and off we go. So we decided that for the months of May, June, July, right until the time that we go to Starfest, we'll probably just stick to our usual visual astronomy of the dark sites and so on. And we'll come back from Starfest next year. We'll do what we did last year to pick up the supernova search again. The break might also be good for us to get us away from the crowd. You don't want to burn yourself out on it, because it is, I think, going in there night after night or every other night for months on end, knowing that you're going to see the same galaxies and they're probably all going to look the same. It's just one of those things. So the break will be good for us. It's nice to get away from it. The idea of keeping better records and organization of records is definitely on the agenda. We've already changed our record form from the main set to see in their way, as seen from what we had earlier. You go back and try to understand those a couple months later, it can be quite a bit of work just to get your heads together, a couple people saying, yeah, okay, we've got this ready, you know what happened. We plan on submitting photometry on as many supernovas as we can image that are visible to us while we're doing our work. The idea of getting magnitude estimates and sending them to the IAU keeps us at the level, keeps us known to the IAU, gives us the credibility that we need. Hopefully that way we'll go before another one. It won't be a matter of weeks before we chance to get confirmed. It will be a matter of days, or even less, hopefully. More upgrades to the observatory are online. I guess they've already started. The idea of dome control. One thing they've mentioned is the scope slips fine. It will slip from one galaxy to the next, but if you start moving too far, all of a sudden you realize when you take a picture, the picture comes back. Blank. Oh, dome's in the way. Dome doesn't slip. So every 10, 20 minutes or so, when this has to look at each other, kind of pull straws or argue about who's going to go up the cold and turn the dome thing. So dome control is definitely in order. The idea of faster motions, faster sloop, will speed up the search, as well as give us the ability to sloop at larger distances to more galaxies. There is also the idea of some automation in the way of getting to the point that I think Dave mentioned at one time, so that the person could sit in front of the computers and watch the images come up, compare it to the other images, basically save it, and it's going to be on the next one. People will take the images and you watch those images. That really begin not being dead. That's in the far future. I think the idea of dome control and stuff is in the near future. The major thing is, I think you mentioned that data.
We had something announced at the Halifax Center has been long, last couple of years, working on a project of getting our own observatory. So right now we don't have an observatory here on the permanent site. And when I get back from this GA, we're going to be trying to lease a piece of property to hopefully build an observatory. So perhaps in GAs to come, we can keep you guys abreast of our programs and hope to build the largest telescope east of, not Mont Lagenti. We hope to build a 125 to 30 inch ALTAS computer controlled observatory. And if that happens, the search will continue from dark skies. Perhaps we can be a little more efficient up there in dark skies. So that's going to happen. And we've got a fair amount of money now to actually build the structure. We're going to have to find money to build it also. It's going to be a lot of fun. Hopefully the time doing that will be affecting our supernova search. And that's the end of our talk. If anyone has any questions,